Welcome to Superior Profit Weekly Market Roundup, 2nd June 2018. I am Sagar Nandi, Chief Analyst and Trader at Superior Profit based in Singapore. I will not take time to introduce myself. If you want to know more about me, the company Superior Profit, or more importantly, how it may help in your trading, you can visit the website superiorprofit.co and click on the About menu. Before we begin, we go through the standard disclaimer. This demonstration is for educational purposes only. It is designed to share information on Superior Profit's trading system. The information presented here should only be used by people who are aware of the risk inherent in trading. Past performance is no guarantee of future return. Superior Profit is not an investment advisor. This session is not for any recommendation of buying or selling stock or any other instrument. Superior Profit will have no liability for any investment decision made by its audience. As usual, we will look at technical charts of oil and gold. They tend to impact related stocks. We try to align our trades with multiple forces from different levels of the market structure. We try to align it with the broad market. For that, we need to know where the market is going. We study that using market breadth of NASDAQ and NYSE and also using technical charts of 4 broad market ETFs. In addition to aligning with the market, we like to align the trades with industry strength and weakness. We study that using industry scorecard and heat map. We'll do this top-down analysis and try to identify trades that we could take in last couple of weeks and also look for potential trades for the coming week. Along the way, we may go through some of the recent ideas shared in our traders forum or the social network pages. That was the last slide of my presentation. Let's move to live system. We begin our commodities analysis using oil. We are looking at oil ETF USO using weekly backdrop chart and daily hop-on chart. Together, we call this at-a-glance template because it helps us decide if there is a low-risk swing trade entry at the right edge of the chart in a few seconds. Earlier, oil was going up strongly. We had a series of bullish cyan color candles in the weekly chart. Then for 2 successive weeks, it dropped, and it dropped with heavy activity. At the right edge, it is sitting right on top of the trend line support. In the daily chart, it went up with successive higher lows and higher highs. It displayed a bearish headwind signal, possible reversal signal at this point and again at this point. There was no bearish short trade setup according to our unambiguous checklist. Looking at the possible reversal signals, what we could do is to protect profit in existing long positions using trailing stop. That would be a good idea because after this reversal signal, it dropped heavily. At the right edge in the daily chart, it is below lower boundary. It is oversold. It is too low to try to take any short trade right now. And also, it is sitting right on top of the support trend line. It is clearly bearish, so we are not going to try any long trade. And it is oversold. So we are not going to try any short trade either. Looking at oil sitting right on top of the support lines, both in weekly and daily, there is a possibility that oil will reverse from here. That is not for swing long trading, but day traders may look for potential reversal and a trade in the long direction. Now we are looking at gold ETF, GLD, using the same at a glance template. In the weekly chart, gold has dropped after creating a double top. That is where the watermark resistance was there. On this candle, it tried to reach to the watermark level and then drop from there. The weekly candles colors are bearish magenta for many weeks now. There is not extreme high or very high activity in the weekly chart. It is clearly underperforming the market, as we can see from the relative performance line tilting downward. In the daily chart, earlier I observed that price came to the lower boundary lines. That time it was oversold. We would not like to take any short trade anymore. Plus, the possible reversal signal had come, bullish reversal signal, and it was at trend line support. Looking at that time I mentioned in the weekly market roundup that for day trading purposes we may look for long trades, because for next few days gold might go up. That happened, and when it went to the value area, to the white direction line and the resistance trend lines, I also mentioned that there is a likelihood that the up move will stop there because there were too many resistances. That also came true in the last week and this week as well. It is contained inside the triangle pattern, bound by the resistance trend line on the top and support trend line at the bottom. There is no clear trend for swing trading. We may wait for the triangle to be broken for gold to decide on a clearer direction before trying our next swing trade. We saw that both the commodities are falling down. Though they are oversold, there is no short trade opportunity, but the oil and gold both were dropping. What about the broad market? Let's study that. We first study that using NASDAQ composite index and NYSE composite index, both using weekly charts. And a number of internals, three pairs of internals, new high lows, advanced declines, and up down volume for NASDAQ and NYSE. The broad market displays a mixed picture. NASDAQ strongly went up. The candle color remained green, bullish. And in the weekly chart, it became overbought. We know that because a green dot has appeared on top of the candle. On the other hand, NYSE actually dropped little bit on a closing basis. It tried to go to the trend line supports and then bounced up from there. The candle shape is bullish, however on a closing basis it declined little bit. What about the internals? All the six internals went up this week and all of them closed above zero, shown by the cyan colors at the right side. So the internals are clearly bullish. NASDAQ internals are stronger than NYSE. NASDAQ is clearly going up, whereas NYSE is at support but not going up. This paints a mixed picture. I sometimes listen to other traders. When the S&P 500 is leading the market, they are very happy that the large stocks are going up, so the market must be very strong. And then after some days, Dow Jones Industrial Average starts to lead and they say, this is the best time of the market because the industrials are going up, they will drive the economy up. And then after some days, Russell 2000, the small cap stocks going up. And they start saying, this is the best time because people are taking risk. It is risk on. They are buying small cap stocks, risk on, and that must be very bullish. And when NASDAQ is going up, they say they cannot expect anything better because tech stocks always lead the market. It confuses me a lot. I don't know how it doesn't confuse them. We need to stick to one particular story. Cannot keep on changing stories to fit a narrative that we have of the market. If we rely on Russell 2000, we have to use Russell 2000 all the time. If we rely on Nasdaq, we have to rely on Nasdaq. If we keep on changing, saying this is the best index, this is the best ETF to track the market, I think in a way we are misleading ourselves. We don't do that in superior profit philosophy. We would like to see that multiple factors are bullish together. Not one is bullish, another is bearish, and we somehow still conclude it is bullish. Keeping that in mind, we cannot say that the market is strongly bullish because NYSE in fact closed down. Is it bearish? No, it is certainly not bearish. This study is using longer term weekly charts and broad indices. So it is to be used for longer term investments, not so much for swing trading and certainly not for day trading. And for that purpose, until these support trend lines are broken, we have to say over longer term, both Nasdaq and NYSE are in uptrend. However, looking inside from the right edge, there is mixed picture. That is our conclusion from the market breadth analysis. Let's see whether the broad market ETFs tell us the same story or a different story. Now we are looking at the four broad market ETFs using technical analysis. We are starting with S&P 500 ETF SPY. We are looking at it using weekly and daily charts together. In the weekly chart, for four successive weeks, S&P 500 is not moving anywhere. On a closing basis, it is staying inside very narrow range. At the right edge, the candle color is bullish and the shape is also bullish. So there is no bearish signal in the weekly chart. In the daily chart, it is gradually going up. That's what we see from the higher lows. The higher highs are not that prominent. Looking inside from the right edge, it is moving somewhat sideways. That is not a good situation to try to take swing trades. And when S&P 500 is moving in a sideways range for several weeks now, many stocks may be doing the same. And there is a higher chance of getting stopped out in swing trades. The Nasdaq Composite Index was stronger than NYSE Composite Index. And QQQ is also clearly stronger than SPY. In the weekly chart, it is in clear uptrend. On a closing basis, it is going higher, though the activity is very minimal. The uptrend is evident in the daily chart as well. It broke above the pivot resistance, the watermark resistance, on Friday with very high activity. That is a bullish sign. However, in Q trading, if it is already near the upper boundary, it is a bit late to enter a long trade. Therefore, we are not going to try any swing long trade in QQQ right now. It is bullish, therefore we are not going to try any short trade either. Therefore, for trading purposes, neither SPY nor QQQ has any swing trade opportunity right now. Dow Jones Industrial Average ETF, DIA, is weaker than both SPY and QQQ. We can see that from the relative performance line tilting down. On a closing basis, DIA closed lower, though the candle shape and color of this week both are bullish. Activity is very low. In the daily chart, looking from the right side, it is moving sideways. if we look at the activity pattern, we see the higher activity days indicated by these green dots are bearish red color. So DIA doesn't give us any confidence in taking long trades. It is very close to a trend line support, therefore we are not going to try any short trade either. The last broad market ETF that we study is Russell 2000 ETF IWM. This is the only one that several weeks ago broke out of this pivot resistance, watermark resistance in the weekly chart, came to all-time high. This week it made another new all-time high. Weekly chart candle pattern is clearly bullish. Activity is very muted. The bullishness is displayed in the daily chart. It is going up strongly. IWM displayed a possible reversal signal few days ago. There was no short trade setup. We would protect profit using trailing stop. That same possible reversal signal has come again on Thursday. Thursday, IWM fell with the highest activity we have seen for many days. However, there was no short trade setup on this day if we follow the unambiguous checklist. What we would do? We would continue to protect profit using trailing stop. Friday's candle shape was very indecisive, a doji-like candle. This is no time to take long trade in IWM as well. Because of the existence of the possible reversal signal, because of the indecisive shape candle, and also because it is already at upper boundary. That is, it is overbought. If we combine the information from the market breadth analysis and the market ETFs analysis, we see some categories of stocks are going up. That is Nasdaq stocks and small cap stocks, Russell 2000 stocks. Whereas S&P 500 stocks and Dow Jones Industrial stocks are not going up. They are not going down as well, but not going up. This paints a mixed picture, objectively speaking. We are not in the camp where we will say because Russell 2000 is going up, market is bullish. We take a more holistic view, and going by that approach, we have to say market is neutral. It is at or near all-time high, therefore we may be cautious about taking long trade. Though market level, our conclusion is neutral. Using sector, industry, stock drill down, we can always find low risk trading opportunities. We start with sector performance analysis. Every week we study 11 sectors across 3 review periods. The red bar indicates performance of this week, green bar performance of 1 week prior to the red bar, and blue bar performance of 2 weeks prior to the green bar. Together, they give us performance of 4 weeks or about 1 month of performance. Any bar coming to the right of the zero line indicates the sector went up. Any bar going to the left of the zero line indicates the sector went down. This week, 5 sectors went up, 6 went down. And the ascending sectors went up by larger percentages. Therefore, at a sector level, the market seems to have a small overall bullish bias. We see the red bars are larger on the positive side than on the negative side. Information technology and consumer discretionary are up for all the 3 review periods. Information technology has all the 3 bars to the right of the zero line. And the same is true for consumer discretionary. That means these 3 sectors are going up for at least 1 month. For swing trading, the best opportunities had come at that time, and using QH, sector, industry, stock drill down, we could identify the opportunities at that time. Can we still take long positions? We could still take, but if we had taken long positions in consumer discretionary and information technology when they started to go up, then we would have much higher profit. That is our preferred approach. Because they are already up for at least 1 month, for swing trading, we may be cautious. It may be time that some of the stocks will pull back, at least for a while. Let's look at financials. It is now down for 2 successive weeks. Both the green and red bars are to the left of the zero line. On Saturday, 19th May, in the weekly market roundup, I had warned about financials. That warning was based on the QH drill down analysis, and using that warning, you could protect profit in financials and could probably take short trades as well. This was the snapshot used in the weekly market roundup 2 weeks ago. At that time, I had mentioned that financials and infotech, this arrow was pointing wrongly to telecom, financials and infotech both were the strongest over 12 months period, 1 year period. However, in recent periods, they were decelerating. Whenever a sector or industry starts to decelerate, we are careful about holding long stocks in those sectors and industries. So the warning came in the weekly market roundup of 19th May itself. In the subsequent week, I reiterated the warning on financials. At that time, financials was the second worst performing sector. Coming back to this week's analysis, we see that financials is the worst performing sector. So for 3 weeks, we are observing financials slowly deteriorating. Using that, we could easily protect profit in financial stocks and also look for short. Similar situation happened in utilities. Watching the past market roundups, you can see that utilities was one of the best performers in recent periods. It was strong. And if we drill down, we can see that electric utilities was one of the best performers industries in the sector. Using QH, we could drill down further and find stocks that are strongest in this industry. Utilities sector and electric utilities industry, we could find OGE. At present also, OGE pays a dividend of 3%, has recent quarters earning growth and medium valuation. We could take a long trade in OGE using trend following approach. And as utilities declined this week, OGE also pulled back from the upper boundary line. Upper boundary lines are our initial profit targets for swing long trade opportunities. We are always going to book at least partial profit at those price levels. And the reversal of OGE shows that that is the right approach. We cannot expect every stock to keep on going up every time we take a swing trade. For long-term investment, the approach may be different, but for swing trading, it is better to book at least initial profit at a predefined target level. And the boundary lines give us those target levels for trend following swing long opportunity. Let's have a look at utilities sector using QH, drill down to its industries, see how we could see electric utilities industry to be one of the strongest, and then drill down to OGE's fundamentals, finally look at its technicals. Using such top-down approach, we can identify the strongest stocks in the strongest industries in the strongest sector, having all the forces aligned with the trade before we take it. For top-down analysis, we can use QA that works in real time. All the analysis is done in real time, or we can use the offline stock scorecard based on end of day data. The calculations are little different because the source of the data is different. We could use either of them. For this utilities drill down, let us use the offline sector industry stock scorecard. Every time we open this offline scorecard or the real-time QA, it displays the analysis on 11 sectors, and if we go to the industry tab, hundreds of industries. For each of the items, it does the analysis across 12 monthly review periods, and then more frequently over 10 days, 5 days, 2 days and 1 day. Usually we focus on the 5 days period because that is the primary period for deciding trade entry, both for swing trading as well as long term investing. For every period, Q Systems assigns a score. We can sort by double clicking on any of the columns. It assigns a low score to the worst performing sector, high score to the best performing sector, and also applies a color gradient, cyan to the best performer, magenta to the worst performer. The result is a scorecard and heat map that instantly tells us which sectors are weak now. Materials, financials, energy. Which sectors are strong? Utilities, real estate. Healthcare is mixed. We can see it is vacillating between 9, 10, 11. Whereas utilities and real estate, they were weak earlier. We can know that instantly from the magenta color in earlier review periods, and now it is turning bullish. So it does tell us which sectors are strong now. It also tells us which sectors are going up after being weak in earlier review periods. Other than the scorecard itself, it also calculates acceleration, deceleration using the pace columns. We can double click again. We can see consumer staples is now the best accelerating sector, and telecom services is the most decelerating sector. Usually we look at the 5 days period. Sometimes for precision trade decisions, we may open up the 2 days and 1 day period acceleration deceleration scores, but usually we stick to the 5 days period. Utilities is strong now. In fact, it is the strongest sector using offline scorecard. We can drill down to the underlying industries simply by clicking the drill down button. The industry panel will show all the utilities industries only. We can again double click on the 5 days column to get the strongest industries to the top. Electric utilities is the strongest at present. To look at the stocks, we can drill down again and go to the stock panel. It shows only the electric utilities stocks. The stock panel has many information about the stocks, including the vital statistics. For most decisions, the vital statistics information is sufficient. Sometimes if we want to gather more information, we can move to the right, scroll to the right to gather information, basic information on the stock, performance analysis, fundamental data analysis, and growth analysis for earnings and revenue growth. Most of the time, vital statistics have some need. If we want to sort the stocks based on valuation, we can simply come to the valuation primary column and double click on it. The best value stocks come to the top. The best value stocks have scored in cyan color and the worst value stocks have scored in magenta color. Yellow colors mean the valuation is in the middle. We can identify a stock as fundamentally strong either based on valuation, the valuation primary column, or based on earnings growth. If we want to identify strong growth stocks in utilities, we can sort on the recent quarter earnings growth, EPS year over year earnings growth for the latest quarter, and we see OGE has one of the best earnings growth in the recent quarter. BIP also has very high earnings growth in the recent quarter, however in prior quarter it was performing very poorly, therefore I had not so much interest on BIP. OGE overall seems to be a better stock with medium valuation and steady earnings growth over last 3 quarters. It pays a dividend of 3.8%. We could identify OGE as one of the best growth stocks in electric utilities when the utility sector was going up and this industry was one of the strongest in utility sector. We could check up the stock using technicals. When the sector was strong, when the industry was one of the strongest, we could drill down to find OGE as one of the strongest stock and then look for potential long opportunities. For trend following long opportunities, we try to catch the low of a swing. We identify a stock that is going up with higher highs and higher lows. We don't try to buy when the stock is making new highs. Instead, we wait for it to pull back, give us a cyan color candle, and take the long trade right at that point. Because we are able to catch the low of a swing, our stop loss is very narrow, just below recent low, and our profit target would be at upper boundary or once the risk distance is covered. OGE very nicely went up, hit the upper boundary. We could book at least partial profit. If we booked partial profit, we would use stop loss in a way, trailing stop in a way, that the entire trade is risk free from that time onward. That would be a good idea because on Friday it dropped. Prior to that, on Thursday, it gave a very indecisive shaped candle with both upper and lower tails, and it was a heavy activity down day. Looking at that, we would be cautious. Anyway, our stop would be in place and we would get stopped out on the remaining position on Friday. Overall, the trade made significant profit. This illustrates the effectiveness of catching the swing low, allowing us to take very low risk trades, and also the necessity of booking partial profit for swing traders at predefined target level. Looking at the weekly chart, the weekly candle shape is pretty bearish. It has a long upper tail. This week's price drop was with heavy activity, not extreme heavy activity, but heavy activity. In the daily chart, there are multiple support levels. We are not expecting any short trade in OGE right now. However, it was a good idea to book partial profit and put trailing stop to exit the remaining position also on Friday. This is how, using top-down analysis, we could identify a strong stock in a strong industry, in a strong sector, that was also at a low risk technical buy point. Take the trade confidently, book profit with discipline, and exit the trade before the stock could drop further. That is the superior profit approach of trading, swing trading. Let us now move to industry analysis. We'll find some interesting stocks from this top-down analysis. At sector and market level, forces tend to neutralize each other. There are too many forces, some pushing stocks up, some pushing down. At industry level, stocks tend to move more homogeneously. We are looking at 10 of the best performing industries of this week. The best performing industries went up by between 3.4 to 12.5 percentages. These are significant gains for a week. They are distributed among multiple sectors. Securities and alarm services is the best performing industry. Some of these industries have very few stocks inside them. Therefore, we have to be careful and not break down the market into too many industries. If we break down the market into too many industries, then the industry level analysis will not be effective. In my view, both S&P 500 and Thomson Reuters does a good job of dividing stocks into industries, but not so many industries that the industry level analysis becomes less effective. Security and alarm services does not have many stocks. We could drill down to the stocks and find this stock, Brinks, BCO. The industry's up move was largely because of this stock going up. There was a significant news. It announced acquisition of another stock and said that it is going to accelerate their earnings. That may be treated as a major news. Because it went up strongly, it cleared multiple resistance trend lines and also pivot resistance levels, has created a swing high. It is overextended. You may wait for it to pull back and look for a low risk buy opportunity. And the same is true for the third best performing industry, automobile manufacturer. General Motors, it is optimally valued now. It is a modest dividend of 3.5%, went up by 12.8% this week, breaking out of narrow sideways range. There is a trendline resistance nearby, so we may not take a long trade right now, but we may keep an eye on this stock as well. GIII does the analysis of the sectors and industries in a similar way as the offline scorecard. It analyzes hundreds of industries. To get the best performing industries, we double click on the 5 days primary period. The best performers come to the top. Their scores are in cyan color. In all Q systems, be it technical systems, fundamental systems, industry analysis system, cyan or green means good, and magenta or red means poor. We say security and alarm services is the best performer. We could drill down to its stocks in real time using the drill down button. To save time, we will go to offline scorecard and look for the stock BCO. In the offline scorecard, currently we are looking at the electric utility stocks. We can click the refresh button to get all the stocks, filter for BCO. And if we want to do a peer analysis of BCO, we can click the magnifying glass. That will bring all the stocks in the scorecard that are BCO peers. Apparently in the scorecard there is no other stock. If we want to retrieve all the pairs of BCO, we can use QFighter. In the scorecard, it didn't retrieve any pairs because scorecard is limited to 2500 stocks, and these stocks are selected based on their liquidity and also stock price. If the price is too low or if the liquidity is not good enough for swing trading, then we don't want to focus on them. That's why the scorecard doesn't include such stocks. For a complete pair analysis, we can always use QVital. In QVital, we can put any stock in the world. It can be used for global investing. Choose a relationship based on which we want to do the analysis. We can choose industry pairs, sector pairs, country pairs, or even global pairs. We can also look for similar industries by choosing industry plus. Let's choose industry. Click on the pair selection button. In real time, it goes to Thomson Reuters and tries to find the pair stock. It has identified four stocks. Clicking the calculator button will retrieve data from Reuters again, extremely reliable data, and calculate the vital statistics. We can see from the vital statistics panel that BCO is medium valued in terms of valuation, the primary valuation column. In terms of earnings growth in the recent quarter, it has increasing earnings growth. Also, for yearly earnings growth, it is positive, coming in bright green color. So respectable earnings growth over 1 year, 2 year, as well as 3 year periods. We can go to scorecard, refresh the data with the security stocks, and go to the performance panel to the right. Over 5 days period, we can double click to sort them by performance, and we can see BCO. These two are same stocks, BCO and BCO.N. BCO went up by 15%. So this is a stock in the best performing industry that went up sharply. We can see the other stocks actually didn't go up. That's why I mentioned that the industry strength is based on this single stock going up. That is fine. We can still look for buy opportunities in the stock, provided there is such an opportunity on the charts. Let's look at BCO's chart. This is BCO using at a glance template. In the weekly chart, it came to this pivot support level, watermark support level. 1 week ago, it tried to go below that, but if you look closely, it closed above the support level. And this week, it went up sharply from that level. Weekly activity was very high. In the daily chart, there was a bullish possible reversal signal at this point that nicely caught the low, swing low at that time. Price went up. At the very top, it displayed a possible reversal signal. So this was a bullish reversal signal and this was a bearish reversal signal. Both of them worked very well. After the bearish reversal signal, price came down to the same pivot support level which had displayed bullish reversal signal earlier. I discussed it in many other sessions that if a stock displays bullish reversal signal, price goes up from there. When price comes back to the same level, some buying may still be left. And we also see price tried to go below the support level, reverse from there, creating a false downside breakout, thereby it seems shaking off weak hands. There was a very big gap up day on the news that they were acquiring another company. On Thursday, it was a large gap up day. We could identify the stock using our sonar program, gap open sonar, and we could take a long at that point itself using gap trade setup. For that day, stop will be just below day's low. And we could book partial profit at the high of the day. Partial position might be held if somebody analyzed the sector's industry's fundamentals and saw that the stock was strong along those dimensions as well. Trying to buy the stock at the close of Thursday would not be a good idea according to our trading philosophy, because the stop would be very far. If we could take the trade using real-time trade entry technique, gap long trade setup, that would be fine. Otherwise, we would not like to take a long position on close of Thursday. What to do now? The stock seems fundamentally strong. Industry is strong because of this stock going up, but still we have to say industry is strong. Now somebody may wait for a pullback and then the stock to go up, giving us a low risk entry opportunity. Another possibility is that if the stock goes sideways for a while and then breaks above this pivot resistance, the watermark level, then one may try another low risk entry. I mentioned that BCO cleared many resistances. Some of them are visible here. The watermark resistance that came near the bearish headwind, possible reversal signal. The other resistance lines were also there, and we could find them by changing the template using hotkeys. This template is very useful in seeing a stock change trend from downtrend to uptrend. When a stock is in downtrend, it has multiple resistance trend lines. We can see at least four of them here. And as the stock creates a bottom and starts to go up, it breaks all the resistance trend lines one by one. As of Thursday, it has cleared all the daily resistance trend lines. In the weekly also, it has cleared the resistance trend line. Only one was there. Now there is no more resistance trend line above price. It is open space. Therefore, if we have a low risk entry opportunity, we'll be happy to take it as a trend following long trade opportunity. Automobile manufacturers, third best performing industries, we found the stock General Motors there. Again, using Q stock scorecard, we can instantly do a peer analysis of the industry stocks. We found GM. Just clicking the magnifying glass will retrieve GM's peers and help us do the peer analysis. General Motors. Instantly, from the color coding, we know it is having very nice valuation. Pays a decent dividend, 3.5%. Let's look at its technicals. Again, we have a stock, General Motors, that nicely broke out of resistances. It broke out of the pivot resistances, and if we change template, we could see it broke out of several trend line resistances as well. One caution is that General Motors is very close to the resistance trend line, both in daily as well as weekly. That's why I mentioned for GM, we may wait for this resistance to be clear or for it to pull back and go up, giving us a low risk entry opportunity. Now we are looking at the worst performing industries of this week: houseware and specialties is the worst performer. NWL in this industry dropped by 11% in last 2 weeks after signaling a trend following short opportunity on 18th May. At that time, the weekly was already bearish, so we were happily going to take the short trade. Using our trade setup, the risk was very small. How was it in terms of fundamentals? NWM is the worst among peers. That also would support going for the short trade. It has negative recent quarters earning growth and poor earnings quality. On the other hand, in the same industry, though the industry is worst performer, the stock LBY, it is the best among NWL's peers. LBY is nicely holding on to its base. The second worst performer is motorcycle manufacturers. Only one stock there we know, HOG. We discussed it in last market roundup. It is a value stock. We were thinking of taking a long trade if it gave a low risk entry opportunity. That opportunity didn't come. The stock is still holding on to its base, still a value stock. We may wait for it to give us a proper buy point. By the way, the worst performing industries fell by smaller percentages than the industries that were best performers. That also shows that at industry level, market is slightly bullish. We found that out from the sector level as well. Let's look at the houseware and specialty industries, motorcycle manufacturers industry, and drill down to these stocks, NWL and HOG. In QH, to find the worst performing industries, we double click on the 5 days period. The worst performers come to the top. Houseware specialties is the worst performer, and this industry was weak for a long time. Motorcycle manufacturers, weak for a long time. Let's look at NWL and HOG in these two industries. Now, peer analysis is very easy using scorecard. We just locate the stock and click on the magnifying glass, the analyze button. We have three stocks here, houseware and specialties industry. All of them are optimally valued. But if we look closely, LBY is the best among them because it is optimally valued and also has recent quarters earning growth, also pays the biggest dividend. NWL is in fact the worst among these three. The dividend is also the smallest. Earnings quality is poor, whereas the other two stocks have cyan and yellow colors in earnings quality. Let's look at NWL using technical charts. As the industry was lagging, the stocks were expected to be at a lower price. This stock also fell a lot. It tried to go up and then started to decline again. On this day, 2 weeks ago, it gave a magenta colored candle. By that time, price already started to go down, try to recover, fall down right from the yellow direction line. So at that point, when the magenta candle came, price was reversing from the yellow direction line as well as magenta and cyan direction lines. For swing short opportunities, we look for magenta colored candles when the stock is in a downtrend, which was true at this point. We could take a short trade there, put stop just above recent high, entry price will be this level. We could book partial profit at the lower bounded. As the stock fell below that with very high activity, we could book partial profit. However, it is always useful to let profit run, especially when the stock is one of the weakest in the industry, the industry itself is weak, and technically the stock is falling, so we can let profit run on the remaining short position. let's look at its peer stock LBY. It was fundamentally the strongest. Though the industry is very weak, LBY is the strongest among peers in terms of fundamentals. Let's look at LBY's technicals. LBY is holding on to its base much better. In the weekly, it is moving sideways. Interestingly, in the daily, it displayed a possible reversal signal, the bearish reversal signal, and very next day, it had a huge gap down day. From close of this day to next day's open was a huge gap down. That is why whenever the reversal signal appears, we are always careful about long positions, and if the unambiguous checklist conditions are met, we are happy to take a short trade. At the right edge, we see that though it was a large gap down day, it recovered sharply. So on that day, using real-time chart, we could take a gap long trade, probably at the lower end of the candle, using real-time 5-minute chart, putting stop just below day's low. And we could book partial profit at the close of that candle, holding on to the remaining position. Technically, this stock is much better than, we don't have any long opportunity yet, but if the industry starts to go up, then this would be the stock to go up first before others. Probably. We are never certain, but this has a better looking technical chart forming a nice base. It recovered very nicely from this huge gap down day. It had extreme high activity. That must be due to strong buyers coming in. After that, price is moving sideways. If it goes up and the industry strengthens at the same time, this may be a good buy opportunity where fundamentals, industries and technicals would align at that time. The other stock that we discussed in last market roundup also, HOG, I will not go through its industry and fundamental analysis again. Let's look at the technical chart following up on what we discussed last week. By the way, all the market roundups are available in YouTube channel. You are welcome to view them. This is Harley Davidson, HOG. Fundamentally, it is a value stock. Dropped a lot in the weekly, creating a base. In daily, it is still inside this narrow range. It tried to go up precisely reverse from the yellow descending direction line. That's why we are careful of those declining direction lines. Now it came down. Friday had heavy activity indicated by the green dot. Friday's candle has a long lower tail. The shape is mixed, solid body but long lower tail. There is no bullish signal. However, if the price recovers and breaks above this trend line resistance and watermark resistance, it may give a very low risk value buy opportunity that may be a swing trade opportunity and may also end up being a long-term investment opportunity. That is how we could identify the apparel stocks, VFC, etc., when they were starting to go up. People were not looking at them. Now, all these stocks, apparel stocks, are at the very high level and people are saying, I'll buy this. They are competing against each other. Who to buy first? That is also fine. Nothing wrong with that. Is that if you could buy the same stock at a lower price, observing industry turning around at the same time, stock turning around at the same time, why wouldn't you do that? Why people don't do that? There is a psychological reason behind it. It is much easier to look at a chart that is already very strong, gone up by 30, 40, 50, 100% and say that is a strong stock, I will buy it. When a stock is at a lower price level, the media and everybody is bearish, it is difficult to buy that stock. But we are okay to buy those stocks because we rely on solid analytics based on fundamentals, industries, and technical. Let's look at accelerating industries, and we have some fantastic stocks here, in my view, based on data, not my subjective assessment. Here we are studying industries that accelerated very fast. We are looking at the scores, the industry strength scores over 5 days and 10 days period. We can see that over 5 days, computer and electronics retail score gained by a very large margin. That's why it came in the accelerating industries list. Steel was already relatively strong, but still it gained a lot. Therefore, steel also came in the accelerating industries list. Two different kinds of industries. One was very weak in score, gained sharply. One was already strong, but still gained sharply. And in computer electronics retail, I found GME. Beautiful stock, isn't it? Massive 11.5% dividend, fantastic valuation, solid earnings quality, and a short squeeze potential. Pretty good chart pattern as well. You may look for a buy opportunity. I think this is one of the best 360 degree analysis stocks we could find. And same in steel industry, Sun, Coke Energy, SXCP, again has excellent valuation, very high dividend of 10.4%. I hope I am not again messing up the dividends, we'll see. Again has very robust earnings quality, displayed a possible reversal signal in the daily chart. Let's go through these stocks. In QH, to find the accelerating industries, we sort by the PACE 5 days column. You can just double click. We can see steel is an industry that accelerated. We know that because the PACE 5 days column score came in cyan color. Also computer and electronics retail, the PACE score came in cyan color, so it accelerated heavily. We can see the very sharp increase in score. Steel was already strong for some time, that's why previous periods have cyan color. Computer and electronics retail was magenta over several months but gained strength sharply. Let's look at their stocks. Instantly our eyes go to GME. It has the best possible valuation scores. Cyan color is also good enough. I just look at the color. Some people like to look at the numbers also. It has the best possible score, both for primary and secondary valuation. I didn't mess up on the dividend. Pays a very, very good dividend of 11.5%. Solid earnings quality shown by cyan color here and a short squeeze potential. Before going to technical charts, let's look at the steel industry stocks. These are the steel industry stocks. We can sort by valuation by double clicking on the primary valuation column. SXCP again has the best possible valuation, very large dividend, 10.4%, good earnings quality. So both of these industries accelerated, and we found two stocks fundamentally very strong in terms of valuation and excellent dividend. Let's look at the technical chart. SXCP dropped, created a watermark support level, and this week closed above that with a bullish shape candle and a bull release signal. In the daily chart, it created a watermark support level, displayed the possible reversal signal. Price tried to go down the support level and reversed, creating a false downside breakout. There is no long trade opportunity yet. If the stock gives a valid Q long trade setup on the charts, then it will probably be very nice to take that trade because it has fantastic dividend as well as fundamental. Let's look at GME's chart. GME again had fantastic dividend, earnings quality, short squeeze potential and valuation, creating a very nice base in the weekly chart. This week it went up with very high activity. This was earnings week. The weekly candle shape and color both are bullish. in the daily, it displayed a possible reversal signal. Amazing, isn't it? How these reversal signals work. That caught the very low. Since then, price is moving sideways on Friday. Because of earnings, it had extreme high activity. Price opened lower, gap down, however, recovered very nicely. It could probably give a gap long trade opportunity using real-time chart on Friday itself. It closed just below the trend line resistance. So at Friday's close, we were not going to take any long trade. Either we could take it near Friday's open using real-time chart, or now we can wait for next week. If next week price opens above the trend line resistance, that will also be above the yellow direction line, starts to go up using real-time chart with very low risk, we can take a long trade. Fantastic fundamentals, industry strength, and technical charts may give a long opportunity next week. If somebody took the long near Friday's market open using gap long trade, they could book partial position, day trading technique, and hold on to remaining position. Let's look at the decelerating industries. And remember what I mentioned about apparel stocks. It decelerated. Doesn't mean that all the stocks are going to fall down. However, we could enter long position in some of these stocks long before, following the analysis in the weekly market roundups, and you could do the same analysis yourself. I found three stocks, GIII, COLM and VF Corporation, VFC. They have reasons to be cautious, both in terms of fundamentals and technicals. We will look at them shortly. And in home improvement retail, we have two stocks, very well-known stocks, Home Depot and Lowe. They are both fundamentally overvalued. None of them have bullish chart at the right edge. Home Depot is in a triangle pattern and Lowe shoot up after earnings and stalled there. Lowe shows a risk to breakout traders. Those trades are often high risk trades where the stop loss is very fast. In QH, to get the decelerating industries, we simply sort by the past 5 days column. The worst decelerators come to the top with magenta color score. We can see apparel, accessories, luxury goods, and home improvement retail both decelerated heavily. Apparel, accessories, luxury goods were strong for a long time. That is when we could buy the stocks, BFC and whatnot. Now is probably not the best time. It may still be time, but not the best time. But not a time to buy stocks in these three that I mentioned. COLM, GIII and BFC. Same is true for home improvement retailers, Lowe's and Home Depot. Let's look at their fundamentals. By the way, using scorecard or age, we could start from the sector level. We could go to consumer discretionary, drill down. All the consumer discretionary industries will be found. And here also, using offline scorecard, we can see apparel, accessory, luxury goods. Has good score, but it decelerated heavily, shown by the paste column being in magenta color. We can drill down. This allows us a complete top-down analysis. Immediately using color coding, we can see VFC, COLM and GIII. From the magenta color, we know instantly they are overvalued. GIII also has poor earnings quality. Let's look at these three stocks using technical chart. When an industry is starting to decelerate and stocks are overvalued, we have to be cautious. If the charts are still bullish, we don't have to exit a position. However, we can protect profit using trailing stop. GIII broke out of the watermark pivot level. And breakout traders are very happy. They are going to buy here. That is not our approach. These stocks are fundamentally overvalued. We could locate these stocks at the lowest point. we can see it went up by more than 100% from 20 below 20 to 42 now. We could catch them as value stocks earlier. If we didn't want to catch them as value, we could buy them in the middle when the stocks were yellow color in valuation. But now they are already magenta color and breakout traders are still going to buy it. Is it possible to buy such breakouts? In my approach, we can still buy provided the fundamentals are strong and industries are also strong. There are stocks like that which are at high price level but still good valuation. Facebook is one of them. And using scorecard, we can easily find them. GIII is not one of them. It is already overvalued. In daily, it broke out of the watermark resistance. However, it had a bearish possible reversal signal. And then for 3 successive days, it has very indecisive candles. There are multiple trend line supports. Longer term investors don't have to worry until these are broken. However, clearly looking at the daily chart from the right edge, I don't see any reason to buy this stock right now. It may be better to put trailing stop on existing long position. COLM, another stock that broke out to new high. It is overvalued. We could buy the stock at double bottom in the weekly chart when it was at value, or maybe in the middle when it was medium valued. Now it is already overvalued. Daily has displayed bear release signal. It broke out above the watermark resistance in daily as well. It may continue to go up, however it is overvalued. That's why I mentioned it is better to protect profit using trailing stop. If it falls back below this resistance level in daily as well as weekly, then it will create a false upside breakout in both weekly and daily, and that will be a time to be cautious. You may watch out for such possible false upside breakout. VF Corporation, VFC, yet another apparel stock that we could catch at the very bottom. We discussed it in the weekly market roundups. Displayed a possible reversal signal in the weekly. So far it is the highest point of the stock. It pulled down from the possible reversal signal, came to the value level, recovered, and now it is at a double top where the possible reversal signal had come earlier. This week's candle is indecisive. In the daily chart, it tried to go to the watermark resistance, went up, broke above the watermark resistance, but failed and closed below it. Thursday had very high activity down day. For longer term investors who bought at this point or this point using 360 degrees analysis, they may not worry until these support trend lines are broken. For swing trading, I would not recommend taking a long trade in VFC right now. There is no Q short trade setup as well. However, looking at the industry's deceleration, we may be careful about existing long positions. Home Depot was one of the darlings of many investors. It was very strong, went up sharply, fell equally sharply, tried to recover. The weekly candles are gradually coming down. The weekly candles' colors are still bullish. In the daily, we have a clearer idea of the stock's move. It is in a triangle pattern, bound by resistance trend lines and support trend lines. Price tried to recover from the low, however, precisely came to this trend line resistance and now moving sideways. Looking from the right side, there is no clear trend. It is inside a triangle pattern. The industry decelerated. So we are not going to take any trade, neither long nor short. Earlier, Home Depot used to be stronger than Lowe's. Both of them dipped in the middle. At the right side, we see now Lowe's is stronger than Home Depot. Home Depot is inside triangle pattern. Lowe's is not inside any triangle pattern. It broke out of the narrow range. And breakout traders might take the long on this day. In fact, we could take a long trade on this candle, but not at the close of the day. It was a gap up day, so we could try to enter the trade near market open using intraday entry techniques. Could book partial profit by the end of the day and hold on to the remaining position. Now the weekly candle shape is very bearish with an upper tail. Daily has displayed a bearish signal. However, price is holding on to the high of the first breakout candle. Therefore, there is no short trade setup. We could try to take a long trade here if it pulls back a little bit and starts to go up, or if it breaks above this resistance pivot after moving sideways. We will take such a long trade only if the industry shows strength. Right now it decelerated, but it may show strength next week. Who knows? How were the fundamentals of these two stocks? These are the stocks in home improvement retail industry. Instantly using color coding, we can see both of them are overvalued. They have recent earnings growth. Usually we don't expect a stock to have both good valuation as well as high growth. They are overvalued but has good growth. So if they go up, we may look for low risk entry opportunities. If such an opportunity comes, probably it will come in low before HD. We can decide that based on the chart pattern. I wanted to discuss three more stocks quickly. Let me skip that. But you may look at these three stocks. I'm not saying whether they have bullish or bearish indications when you look at sector, industry, fundamentals, technicals, but you may have a look at that. GCI is a stock that we discussed in the last market roundup. You may follow up from that using technical. Let me summarize. Looking at the market breadth and the market ETFs, we see that market is at very high level. Small cap stocks are breaking out to all-time highs. However, there is a mixed picture. All the engines are not going up together. Therefore, we have to conclude based on data that the market level picture is mixed. At sector level, the gaining sectors went up by slightly larger percentages. So at sector level, we see more bullishness. Not a lot, but slightly more bullish than bearish. At industry level, we saw the best performing industries went up by larger percentages than worst performing industries. Therefore, at industry level also, there is more bullishness than bearishness. Looking back at the ETFs, we see QQQ strongly going up, IWM going up, Dow Jones Industrial Average is the weakest, and SPY, though on a closing basis, it closed down. It found support at the trend line, the automatically drawn smart trend lines, which are providing excellent support both for the broad market indices, Nasdaq, NYSE, as well as for the ETF. Therefore, we have to conclude that market is not bearish. It is mixed. It is not safe to take short trade. That is looking at the market level. There are stocks that are overvalued. Breakout traders may be taking long trades in them. However, I suggest to check their fundamentals. If the stocks are showing weakness in the fundamentals, then we may avoid them. If we are taking breakout trades, it is best taken in stocks that are fundamentally strong as well. Apparel retailers and several other industries were strong for a long time. The best opportunities to take long have long passed, and we could take longs in those stocks, PFC, etc., long time ago. Some of the apparel retailers have cautionary signs not to exit the trade, but at least protect profit using trailing stop. And using acceleration analysis, we could find two excellent stocks in terms of fundamentals, GME and SXCP. Both of the industries accelerated. The stocks have fantastic valuation, dividend, and earnings quality. You may look for low risk buy opportunities in them. In this way, we can combine the industry strength, fundamental strength, technical strength to find highest probability trading opportunities in all market conditions. That is all that I wanted to discuss in today's session. Thanks a lot for attending. I look forward to seeing you in our next session. Have a great weekend and trade profitably.